to Moments with Marianne. I'm so delighted we're spending this time here today. We have just a phenomenal show coming right up with special guest Jennifer Irwin, and she's here today to talk to us about her new book, Address the Color of the Sky. Jennifer is a native New Yorker with a captivating storytelling ability and a flair for embellishment. She currently resides in Los Angeles and earned her BA in cinema from Denison University. She worked in advertising and marketing and also raised three boys and became a certified Pilates instructor. While she has written screenplays and short stories since her college days, this is her first novel. So let's welcome Jennifer to the show.
Thank you for having me. I really am thrilled.
What a pleasure to have you here. And, you know, what a just a great read your book is. I mean, once I picked it up, I could not put it down.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. I'm extremely pleased with the reviews that have come in. I mean, it's been, for me, a dream come true as a debut novelist to see the reviews just so strong at 4.9 stars on Amazon, which is really incredible.
That is amazing. My goodness, it is such a journey creating a book and getting it ready and then also, you know, pushing it out there and getting such beautiful reviews. So before we get a little bit too ahead, I'd love for you to share with us, what started you on this path of writing this book?
I was going through a divorce and I had stopped writing when I raised my kids, and I decided to start writing again because it made me feel a lot better. And I had written a screenplay in college that had gotten into an arts program in New York, and I springboarded off partially some of the ideas from the screenplay. And I had taught Pilates for a long time, and when 50 Shades of Grey came out, I was really blown away by how it kind of revved up a lot of marriages, and women were like really excited to read it, and it just, the way it blew up. And then also the whole Tiger Woods coming out as a sex addict and a lot of the things that had been going on with that. And I started wondering if there was a possibility of a woman being a sex addict, and just kind of interested in the differences between the male and female sex drive. While at the same time, I wanted to know, why did I marry the wrong person, and wanted to kind of dive into my childhood to see perhaps if there was something there that prevented me from knowing what a good, you know, what a good partner and husband looked like. So I also really dive into a lot of that in the book, and how your childhood affects your relationships and your self-worth, your self-esteem, and it's really this woman's journey to self-love, the book goes back and forth in time, so you really care for her and root for her when you see what she's gone through.
Well, it's so interesting when we write books like this that we pull portions of our own life and what's going on. It's almost a cathartic kind of process in a way when we're able to kind of write, go through that writing process.
Yeah, no, it was extremely cathartic for me, and I started sending out copies just kind of to see where I was with the story and see if people liked it, and I was just blown away by how well people were receiving the story and relating to it, all kinds of women. And one of the things I found teaching Pilates is that women really are all the same, no matter what their socioeconomic background is and their education background. It's really more about wanting to be heard, wanting to have friends and love, just a lot of similarities with women. And I wanted to find characters and build characters that were really relatable to women. They're flawed, but human and relatable, and have been through things that are relatable. So, it's been a really incredible journey for me to see how people have reacted to the book, and just writing it myself, digging deep in my own, you know, childhood, and figuring out I didn't have a positive father figure. How would I know what a good husband was? Kind of dealing with my own childhood realities at the same time. And, of course, hashtag Me Too comes out. And while I was writing the book, Kelly Oxford tweeted her sexual assault story, which asking women to share theirs, and millions of women tweeted. It was really incredibly mind-blowing to me to see how many women have experienced trauma of some kind or another, which is why this book is extremely relatable.
Well, and it's interesting because your book does go across all these different lines where people can read it, especially women. They pick it up and read it and go, gosh, you know, I feel like that, or I've gone through that, or, you know, that's happened to me. And so it makes it so it's kind of a story that the reader feels like they're personally connected with.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I've had some people say, actually a book blogger recently read it, and she said in the review, she's like, wait, I actually relate to a sex addict? How is that possible? You know, kind of surprised by how much she related to her. And, you know, I put things in there about there's some issues like childhood traumas over food and eating, and I think there's a little bit less of that now with more awareness of eating disorders, but like being told to eat everything on your plate, you're going to sit here all night and eat the food, just some things like that where people were like, oh my gosh, that totally happened to me, you know. So it's just little things like that I've just had people kind of write me messages and reach out to me, and I think it has stirred some maybe memories from childhood memories and some of my readers, which I think it's hard, it can be hard, but at the same time cathartic. And just I want people to know they're not alone, and you know, you can get help and you can heal and move forward and find self-love and have healthy relationships. And I actually did that, and I'm in a very healthy relationship now, and it's really nice that you can do that, that you know there's a light at the end of the tunnel, and you can, you know, move forward from there. And the other part of the book that's interesting is just addiction and touching on addiction, because so many people have been affected by addiction, whether directly or indirectly, and seeing what rehab's like and kind of experiencing what is it like to be in rehab? What happens there? Take away sort of a lot of the mysteries of that. That's the story, basically, of how I got to write the book.
Yeah, you got it here. So what was your writing process like? Because I know for a lot of our listeners, they write in, they're like, you know, I'm a writer. How does she even start? Is it in the morning? So what does it look like for you?
It looks agonizing. I'm just kidding. Okay, well, my entire house has to be perfect. I can't have, like, anything out of place. I have a Himalayan salt lamp, a scented candle. I mean, it's really annoying. It's a kind of weird diffuser. Usually I put, like, peppermint oil in it. So I need silence. I can't have music playing. When I was writing the book and working and teaching Pilates full-time, I was writing at night. I'm very productive in the afternoon, evening, which is super annoying because I found that my kids are now off to college, but when they would come home from school, it was right around the time that I would just be feeling completely, you know, ensconced in my writing. But at the same time, you know, you just have to write when you feel that you're the best and the sharpest and you're in that, you know, in that mode, because you can't force it. It has to come, you know. And I played with going back and forth in time and tried writing in timeline format. I think every book should have about 7 drafts. It took me a very long time to write the book because I didn't know what I was doing. And now I know a lot more than I did. So I'm writing a sequel, but it's not going to take me nearly as long as this one did. But I encourage people that want to write a book, and everyone has a story inside them, just get started.
It's the best thing to do is get writing, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, the first draft is just sort of like, blah, you know, get all out, and then you'll figure out where you need to, you know, fix it, untangle the necklace, so to speak. But it's yeah, I think it's been good to, like, for my kids to see me chase a dream late in life. I dedicated my book to women chasing a dream because it's never too late to start something new, to do something interesting that you've kind of always wanted to do, but you're afraid. And fear is what really stops us from doing what we dream about doing. Because we're afraid we're going to fail, we're afraid of rejection. And the failure, I believe me, I know a lot of rejection with query letters. First of all, I didn't understand what a query letter really was, and I also didn't understand how serious, protocol-oriented the publishing business is. There's just a whole process of learning that's extremely, you know, it's tough. But the rejection for me was encouraging. It was, I'm getting a response, whether it's good or bad, something. It's better than nothing, you know? And so I just kept going back to the drawing board and trying and trying and trying. So, until I felt like I got it right.
To make it happen.
The other thing that was really weird for me was I couldn't figure out when I would know when the book was finished. How would I know? How do people know? And then all of a sudden I knew. It was really weird.
And it came together for you, right?
Yeah, it was just this moment where I was like, this is it, I'm finished. I can't believe it, you know? I'm just totally ready to go. And my editor was really amazing because a man editor, which was really great for me because I love getting the male perspective, and he was really choked up. I mean, he was really having his heart ripped out a lot while I was editing the book, and that kind of was a hint to me that this might be a success.
You were on the right path with all of that. And I think a lot of times, for new authors, they start getting into that whole process, and they're like, ooh, am I even on the right path, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, one of the things I'm sort of learning is if you do want to be a writer, know your genre, and read your genre, read as much as you can of the bestsellers that are in that area that you think you want to write in, because you need to write in accordance with your audience and understand who your audience is. You're writing YA, obviously you need to speak in that type of language for, you know, young adults, but it's really, so I typically only read contemporary fiction, adult fiction, women's fiction, because I want to know what the readers are looking for. Last week I had something kind of exciting happen. A literary agent in New York called me, which is really, you know, not following the protocol that normally happens. Mm-hmm. So I was really excited about that, and I'm hoping, you know, to sign with him. And I'd love to have that kind of support for the sequel and to have a big five publisher, you know, supporting the next book. Indie publishing is really hot right now, and there's a huge supportive community on social media, especially Twitter. I mean, it's unbelievable. And that's been a great experience for me, too, to see how supportive bloggers and readers and other authors are.
Yeah, how they all come together to support one another. Mm-hmm. Well, why don't you share with us a little bit about your book? We don't want to give it all away because we want people to go and pick up their own copy of A Dress the Color of the Sky. But why don't you share with us a little bit about the book?
Okay, it's the story of Prudence Aldrich, and she's a mother, wife, a friend, and she has a secret, and her secret is that she's a sex addict. And basically, she's in an unhappy, toxic marriage. She has come to a realization that she has endured some childhood trauma that she buried the memories and wanted to get help. So she comes clean to her husband. She checks herself into rehab, and then the story goes back in time. In the very beginning of the book, she does something kind of shocking on her way to rehab, and so you just at first go, well, who is this girl? I mean, you know, you're not sure you even like her. And then the minute you go through her childhood, you start to care deeply for her. And there's the cast of characters in rehab. I like to call it Girl Interrupted Meets Orange is the New Black. She has some great, there's great characters in rehab in the smoking areas where they share their secrets and talk. And she has a minor slip up where she has a small incident in rehab with another, you know, person there, a patient. Because what I found is that when people are in rehab, they're very raw, and relationships form quickly, which is why they tell people getting sober not to have a relationship for a year, because, you know, it's just better to kind of work on yourself. So there's a lot of that where you learn about rehab and you learn about sober and what people go through when they're getting sober and that kind of thing. And then healing from your childhood, that all is covered in the book. But she has some great friends that I weave through the book, and you start to understand why did she marry this person, and how they were drawn together, how two unhealthy people were drawn together. And I leave the end of hanging pretty much so that you want to know what happens to her.
Well, and that's a good synopsis of the book, where people can kind of get an understanding of what it's about. It dives into it in such a colorful way in many ways.
And there's not, you know, honestly, there's not a lot of sex in the book. Any sex that's in the book is there to move the story forward because, you know, she is a sex addict. So you can sense her desperation and her self-hatred. I write a lot of her voices, the self-talk that she has. Teaching Pilates, I saw that a lot of women, one day they're feeling really great about themselves, and then the next day they might not feel as great about themselves. And a lot of that is the voices we say in our heads. Women are really hard on themselves. So there's a lot of messages in the book that I wanted to address, you know, for women and to help women heal and to find self-love, just things I'm really passionate about. So it was a great venue for me to express that stuff, you know.
Well, and it's a fabulous book. In fact, you don't have just one, you have multiple awards, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was one of the most exciting moments for me, was the validation to compete against other authors, and I won a gold and a silver and a bronze, and they wrote me a letter and said that the judges were extremely blown away by the book, universally, and I was really excited about that. I mean, I can't express to you how much joy that brought me. Because when you're competing against your peers and these judges are reading everyone's work, and to win was really a huge bee in my bonnet. It really was. I was like, oh my gosh. You know? Because there's a lot of dark days. There's a lot of tears. There's a lot of rejection. There's a lot of self-doubt. But for every bad day you have trying to chase your dream, something really great happens that keeps you going. So it's just, you know, that's life. You just have to go with the good and the bad.
So that your advice to new writers to just, you know, go with it and enjoy the good parts of everything that's happening?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I love helping other writers. I think there's so many places where you can get support from other writers, and I think the best thing to do is to start talking about your book, making it a reality, and promote the book even before you've written it. Because building the social media platform, building the followers before the story comes out is really valuable, especially if you're going to be an indie author. And I also think get people to read rough drafts. Don't worry if it's not perfect, because then you can get an idea. Where am I? How's the story coming across? Am I doing right? Do I need to change things? If there's a problem in your story, it's usually upstream. It's in the beginning of the book. So when you query agents, the first three chapters are critical. It has to hook you right in. The first paragraph has to be amazing. You know, there's just things like that are really important. And, you know, I think it's good to just reach out to other writers and ask, you know, how'd you do it? What happened? Look at their blogs and go to their websites. Everybody's really wanting to help other people, you know, that are writers. We're pretty nice people, which is good.
Helping everyone to kind of get their work out there and elevate the message. And so where can people connect with you, Jennifer, and learn more about the book and be part of your community?
Well, I have a website, jennifer-irwin-author.com, and all of my social media links are on that website. I'm on Amazon. I have an author page on Amazon as well. And then I'm on Twitter. I mean, I'm LinkedIn, Pinterest, Twitter, I'm everywhere. Instagram, Facebook, author's page. Everything is Jennifer Irwin Author. I mean, that's very easy to find. But if you go to my website, all my links are there. And I write a lot and update a lot on my website. And anyone that wants to reach out to me, shoot me an email, jenniferirwinauthor@gmail.com. I'll give you some links and some help and tell you kind of where to turn if you need any help or guidance with stuff.
So we've talked about your book and where people can connect with you. Do you have any final thoughts you'd like to leave our listeners with?
I just want to say that I think that everyone should just follow their dreams. If you have something you want to do, like write a book, you need to just go for it and don't be afraid of failing, because it could work out. You never know. You could write a bestseller. And I think that being positive, encouraging, supporting other women is always a really good thing. That's just, you know, good karma. And I don't know, just try to support each other. And I encourage everyone as much as possible. I just want to thank people for reading my book. And it's just really fantastic. And the best way to thank an author is to write a review. That just helps.
Five-star review.
Thank you so much for having me on the show. I mean, just stuff like this is so fantastic, and I'm really grateful. I mean, your show's amazing. It's just so impressive what you've done.
Well, you know what, Jennifer, thank you so much. I so greatly appreciate we've been able to spend this time with you today and, of course, to talk about your book, A Dress, The Color of the Sky. So thank you so much for being here with us.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Jennifer. It's been such a joy to spend this time with you and to talk about your new novel, A Dress, The Color of the Sky. Again, if you're looking to connect with Jennifer, you can do that at jennifer-irwin-author.com. Well, we're at the end of our time today. I would like to thank everyone for tuning in. You're listening to Moments with Marianne. And remember, make every moment count.
In a single moment, your life can change. Moments with Marianne is a transformative hour that covers an endless array of topics with the best of the best. Her guests are leaders in their fields, ranging from inspirational authors, top industry leaders, and business and spiritual entrepreneurs. Each guest is gifted and a true visionary, a recognized leader in her own work, and while teaching others to develop, refocus, and grow, Marianne will bring the best guest and sometimes a special surprise. Don't miss this. You never know just which moment will change your life forever. Moments with Marianne airs every Thursday, Friday, and Sunday at 8 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Mountain Time. Make sure to tune in and visit MomentsWithMarianne.com for more information.